Hey, what's up, Cause Church? We are so glad that you guys are joining with us for our online worship experience today. And you guys are probably at home and you might be kind of losing your minds at this point from being locked in your houses. And I was even laughing this week. My wife, Kristen, and I, we're working from home together. And we still love each other. We're still in this marriage thing together. But in all seriousness, we really are so excited to be able to bring church to your home today and really just celebrate what Jesus is doing. And a great way, a great tool that we are using right now is we just completely redid our whole website and we made it so easy for you to be able to invite people to the virtual worship experience, to be able to put in prayer requests and really just connect with the church. We want to connect with you during these times. And another piece of the website that is so awesome is we have an entire page dedicated just to Cause Kids. And our Cause Kids team has been working so hard putting out content all week long via Instagram, and they're putting together messages and activities for your kids throughout the week. So if you haven't checked that out, go check that out. And I also heard that there is a special surprise waiting for you this week if you go on and jump on that Cause Kids website. So you and your kids do not want to miss out on this. But another thing that we do as a church every single week is we are a church of generosity and we give of our tithes. And I just want to encourage you during this time to continue to give, continue to be faithful with your finances, giving back to God. And really what we want to do with that is we want to continue to be able to put out content like this to serve you and meet you where you're at. But we also want to continue to reach out into our city and be able to lift up the name of Jesus in our city. So I just encourage you, if you've never taken that step before of giving to God of your finances, try it out. It's the place where God says, you can test me in this and see what I will do in your life. And so I encourage you in that. And there's a couple ways you can give. You can give online right now, or you can also download the Cause Church app and you can give that way. But hey, guys, get ready to amen and shout Pastor Aaron down as he brings you this amazing message from God's word.
Hey, Cause Church. Hey, we are so thankful that you're with us at this worship experience online today. I'll tell you what, I feel the power of God in our praise. And we're not physically together today, but we're together in another way. And wherever you might be today, I've been praying that the presence of God would invade your living room, your kitchen, your bedroom, wherever you might be viewing this worship experience and participating in this worship experience from. We're glad you're with us today. We might be quarantined, but hey, come on, church, we are still connected. And I'm believing today that as we join our faith with one another, hundreds of us joining our faith together, that we're going to experience the power of God. We're going to experience refreshing and renewing in the presence of the Holy Spirit today. And in fact, I know that God has something good in store for you today. But come on, if you believe that, why don't you say, I'm ready in the comment section today. Just let us know you're with us. And I want to give a special welcome to anybody that's with us today that maybe hasn't been part of a worship experience before, an online worship experience. Maybe somebody shared this link with you. Welcome. We are honored that you're here with us today. And I know right now during this different time, you can't turn to your neighbor and you can't say, hey, welcome. Glad you're here. And usually we say, hey, let's welcome everybody that's new today. And we clap our hands. We can't do that. So hey, put that clapping hands emoji in the comment section. And if you're new today, all those hands that are there, those are for you. There's hundreds of people that are so excited that you're with us today. Welcome. God has something good in store for you. And hey, I want to let you know right after I get done preaching this message, and I can't wait to preach what God gave to me today, but right after the message, my wife and I, Pastor Rochelle, and I, we're going to jump onto Facebook Live. And you know, under normal circumstances, we'd love to maybe meet you in the lobby, drink some coffee, give you a hug or a handshake, something like that. We can't do that today, but we thought we'd create a little bit of a virtual lobby. So we want to meet you on Facebook Live. Just go and follow the Cause CDA if you haven't already, and jump on there with us. Let's hang out. Let's sort of drink our coffee together, as it were, and we'd love to see you there. And by the way, if you click this link to get here today, subscribe to our YouTube channel. If you haven't done that already, make sure and get all the latest content. We want to continue to minister to you. We want to continue to build you up in your faith through this time. And I'm telling you what, hey, if God can reach from heaven to earth, God can certainly reach through a screen today. We've got a God that transcends all of the boundaries that we sometimes build. And it's Bible says that where two or three of us are together, Jesus says, there I'm going to be in the middle of it. So whether we're together in a room or on the web, come on somebody, Jesus is right there in the middle of it today. And I want to encourage you, Cause Church, don't forget today to make it loud with this link. If you haven't done so already, text this to somebody. Share this to your Facebook wall. Make sure that you know, even though circumstances are changing, the mission remains the same. This is until everyone hears. We believe that God is going to do something great in somebody's life today. And I got so many text messages and emails and DMs all last week with people telling me, hey, I had a friend that said I would never go to church. They were with us online last week. God is changing people's lives. God is continuing to do what God always does because, come on, circumstances might change, but our God never does. The same yesterday, today, and forever. So I'm praying that the presence of God fills up your house today. And, you know, I can't wait. My wife and I, we can't wait to be with you again in person. And we're praying for answers in our nation and around the world. And we're praying for God to heal and make new and restore. And I would encourage you to join your faith with mine that God would shorten the time. And I can't wait to give you a hug. And, you know, one of those hugs where I hold on a little bit too long and it gets kind of awkward. But in the meantime, we're so thankful for this kind of technology that enables us to connect today. So today, I know you couldn't come to church, so hey, come on. The church is coming to you. We're coming right up into your home today. And I'm reminded of one simple fact as we join our faith together online today. Our God is greater. Our God is greater than maybe what kept us up last night. Our God is greater than every headline. Our God is greater than our fear or our anxiety. Our God is greater than sickness. Come on, the name of Jesus is above every other name. If you believe it, come on, say amen in the comment section today. So God, today, come on, let's pray together. We magnify your name. And as we magnify your name, Jesus, we also minimize that which feels to be against us. God, we declare that you are the way and the truth and the life, God. And in this difficult time, we choose worship over worry. God, we come to you today with the eyes of our hearts fixed on you. We look up to the hill where our help comes from. And we believe, God, that every promise remains today. God, would you do something in us? And would you do something through us? And God, I pray that you would do something in somebody's life that would be as if you had me prepare what I'm about to preach just for them, just for that one person, God, that you might speak to them with such specific, God, instruction for their life, God, or comfort for their heart. And Jesus, we give you all the praise and all the glory. And come on, everybody online said, amen. Amen. Last week, if you were with us online, we looked at the time that Jesus woke up out of sleep and stood up on the stern of the ship and calmed the storm. And today I felt like the Holy Spirit highlighted another story of another ship and another storm, but one that actually goes very differently. And I believe God has something to say to us through it today. And trust me, by the way, when I say today that you do not need to hear from me. There is no power in my opinion, but there is something that happens in us if we can hear from heaven. So come on, open up your heart today. Receive what God has for you today. I encourage you to take some notes. Make sure that you're engaged and that you're part of what God is doing in this moment. You know, sometimes when I really get to preaching, somebody would stand up and say something like, hey, say it again, preacher. And if you say that today, I won't be able to hear you, of course, through the screen. But what you could do, because of the power of this online experience, is you could actually just scroll back and you could make me say it as many times as you want. In fact, if you want, you could just pause me right in the middle of my preaching and go finish eating your pancakes if you really want to. But hey, We don't have time to read through it all, but I want to jump into Acts 27. If you have a Bible, if not, no worries, it's going to be on the lower part of your screen. And we're going to look at this time where Paul, the church planter, and if you're new to the Bible or new to the Cause Church, new to walking with Jesus, we're so thankful that you're with us in this moment. And so Paul, this church planter, is in this place where they're sailing. They're supposed to be sailing to Rome to stand trial, but as they set sails, they run into a storm. And I'm going to read about 12 verses, and we'll grab a few more as we get there. Church, I've been waiting to preach this to you. Acts 27, verse 13 says this: "When a gentle south wind began to blow, they saw their opportunity. So they weighed anchor and sailed along the shore of Crete. Before very long, a wind of hurricane force called the Northeaster swept down from the island. The ship was caught by the storm and could not head into the wind. So we gave way to it and were driven along. As we passed to the lee of a small island called Cauda, we were hardly able to make the lifeboat secure, so the men hoisted it aboard. Then they passed ropes under the ship itself to hold it together because they were afraid they would run aground on the sandbars of Syrtis. They lowered the sea anchor and let the ship be driven along. We took such a violent battering from the storm that the next day they began to throw the cargo overboard. On the third day, they threw the ship's tackle overboard with their own hands. When neither sun nor stars appeared for many days and the storm continued raging, we finally gave up all hope of being saved. After they had gone a long time without food, Paul stood up before them and said, 'You should have taken my advice not to sail from Crete. This is a biblical, I told you so. You should have listened to me. Then you would have spared yourselves this damage and loss. But now I urge you to keep up your courage, because not one of you will be lost.'" Come on, somebody needs to hear that today. Not one of you will be lost. "Only the ship will be destroyed. Last night, an angel of the God to whom I belong and whom I serve stood beside me and said, 'Do not be afraid, Paul. You must stand trial before Caesar. And God has graciously given you the lives of all who sail with you. So keep up your courage, for I have faith in God that it will happen just as he told me. Nevertheless, we must run aground on some island.'" I want to preach to you for the next several minutes using as a subject, "Since I'm here." Since I'm here. And I can relate to the opening of this passage. It tells us, the readers, that as they set out, it wasn't so much a storm that came out of nowhere or hit really super suddenly, but it was a gentle south wind, the Bible says. It was blowing, but before long, what was just a little headwind all of a sudden became a hurricane. And I think there's something in a lot of us that can sometimes try to ignore the wind, at least as long as we can. After all, we're faith people. So, you know, we'll say stuff like, "Hey, ain't nothing but a little wind. Hey, we got this. It's nothing to our God. It's no problem. It's nothing but a virus that's somewhere on the other side of the planet." But sometimes, though, a headwind becomes a hurricane that simply has to be handled. Sometimes there's some stuff in life that has to be dealt with, or it's going to deal with you. And here's what I want somebody to hear today. Faith, you see, doesn't deny problems, but rather faith changes how you deal with problems. I think as people of faith, it's really key that we know the difference between trying to pretend a problem isn't there and knowing that a greater power is there. Faith doesn't attempt to try and deny the existence of real problems. Faith acknowledges real power that's with us in the problems. We don't deny the existence of the storm. We look to a God that's with us in the storm. Come on, somebody, and say amen. So what was once just a headwind turned into a hurricane. And now they were in a storm unlike any storm that any of them had been in ever before. And I think all of us right now are in something and in circumstances unlike anything any of us have ever been in before. But hey, check this out. When you're in something like you've never been in before, you have an opportunity to trust God like you've never trusted God before. And sometimes it's actually the size of the storm that reveals the size of the Savior. Come on, sometimes the bigger the trouble, the bigger the triumph. Sometimes the greater the problem, the greater clarity you see with and see God's promises. The storm might be big, but your God is bigger. The issue might come at you strong, but your God is stronger. Come on, you might have a real problem, but you've got a real promise. If you believe it today, come on, give me some praise hands in the comments. To me, this passage, as I read through it this week, felt like it was written for right now, for exactly what we're walking through as people and families and individuals. After all, come on, this book is alive and active and accurate to exactly what we're experiencing today. What struck me about this storm in particular, is how different it is than the other storm, the one where Jesus was physically on the boat and they go and wake Jesus up and Jesus speaks to the storm and commands the storm and stands up and shouts peace. In this storm, please hear me, Jesus is just as much on the boat. Not in the same form, not in a physical form, but there in the Holy Spirit. Just like Jesus is with you now in the form of the Holy Spirit right there in your house. Jesus is just as much there on the boat this time, but rather than it was like that time, this time Jesus doesn't speak peace, watch me, but rather uses the storm to push someone into their purpose. Sometimes God will speak peace to the storm. And then there are other times where God will push you into purpose by using the storm. This is so strong in my spirit for somebody today. And so what felt like a disaster was actually God using something to push someone into their destiny. What felt like nothing but a predicament was actually God using something to push someone into a greater place of purpose. And maybe somehow, even in the middle of all this chaos, there is a God that is big enough and great enough and good enough to use it to bring you into your calling. Sometimes, watch me, God will stop the storm. Other times, God will steer you with the storm. It says that after trying to fight against it, they realized it wasn't going to happen. And so they gave way to it and they were driven along. And here's my message, and I'm going to preach this in every other point today. You can't always control where you are or what you're in, but you can always decide who you are. Sometimes you're gonna get thrown into some places that weren't in your plans. I don't know about you, but I did not plan on spending the next 3+ weeks quarantined to my house. We weren't planning on figuring out how to try and homeschool our third grader. Come on, it turns out third grade curriculum is confusing. I think I need to go back to third grade. Come on, somebody, and don't leave me alone. Say amen in the comments. You probably weren't planning on this crisis when you got hired to be a grocery store clerk. You probably weren't planning on your job in the medical field being like it's been. You probably weren't planning on having to make some of the decisions that you're having to make. You probably weren't planning on being where you are. I bet you weren't planning on having to set up an office at home and then try and get your kids just out of view of the meeting that you have to have with your boss, only to have them like dance past in the background in their underwear and embarrass you in front of your boss. Come on, somebody. This is not where you thought you'd be. You can't always control where you are, but you can always decide who you are, and you can always remember whose you are. I belong to Christ. I'm not identified. It's not my identity that I'm somebody that's stuck in a crisis. I belong to Christ. Maybe it's exactly what you'd been thinking God should have dealt with by now. It's actually guiding you into your destiny right now. This is so good. So what happens when this storm, for a while, it decides to stay? Well, we'll hear something. Look at verses 18 and 19. We took such a violent battering from the storm that the next day they began to throw the cargo overboard. On the third day, they threw the ship's tackle overboard with their own hands. So here's a point if you're taking notes on the other side of the screen today. Here's what happens when sometimes the storm stays. You go back to the basics. You go back to the basics. They threw the cargo overboard. It's in a kind of crazy way, when we get thrown into a storm, you can't help but see with new clarity that that sometimes what seems so necessary was actually something that you didn't really need. Here's something I feel like I've been figuring out. Sometimes the extra can actually get in the way of what's truly essential. In fact, sometimes, I don't know about you, but I have a tendency to pick the extra over the essential because I don't always have the wisdom to know the difference. So here comes a storm, and it puts them in a position where they've got to make some decisions. And by the way, I want you to know today that desperation is always a setup for revelation. Sometimes when you're desperate, sometimes when you get in a place, when you're crying out to God like you never have before, you're going to hear from heaven like you never have before. So here comes a storm, and we've all got some extra. And there ain't nothing wrong with having some extra unless that extra is distracting you from what's essential. That's what people are having to decide these days. That's a key phrase, isn't it? What's essential? What's truly necessary? What's essential? And come on, I'm thankful that somebody somewhere decided that coffee and the coffee drive-thru was still essential. Come on, the line was to the back of the parking lot, but praise Jesus the Christ, I still got my coffee. Somebody give me a little coffee emoji if you're with me today. But they had to ask, hey, what's essential? So they threw some stuff overboard that was extra. There's some extras. There's some extras. And some of y'all are going through the fiery trial of a lifetime. You can hardly believe it. You can't really even get your head around that this has actually happened, but they have canceled March Madness. I know you're feeling the pain. I've been praying for you in that pain. Really, though, there's a whole lot of what had been keeping us busy that just got thrown overboard. I wonder, though, if God hasn't thrown some of our extra cargo overboard so that we might get back to some of the basics. You know, I was talking to a few of the people in my virtual connect group. By the way, if you're not part of a virtual connect group, it's actually a lot easier than you might think it is. Jump online to our redesigned website, thecausecda.com. Get in a group. We're quarantined, but we're still connected. And I was talking to some people in my group, and I said, hey, what's changed for you during this time? What's different as we kind of go through this crisis together as a city and as people? And several people actually said, you know what? Because of some of my canceled plans, I found that more often I'm in God's presence. And I thought about that, and I thought, you know, there's something about getting back to the basics that makes my faith get big. There's just something about it. And we might be facing some issues that are very complex, but just because the issues are complex doesn't at all take away from the fact that Jesus makes the answers clear. Get back to the basics. Open your Bible more than you open your news app. Get back to the basics and remember and rehearse the promises of God. Get back to the basics and turn up your Bluetooth speaker and sing in your out-of-tune voice and declare the worship of God. I'm telling you, there's something about the basics. My wife and I, we laugh sometimes that, you know, in those times of life, kind of like now when there's a lot going on around us and maybe we've got some reasons that we could slip into anxiety or worry or panic. For some reason, we always go back, you know, there's nothing wrong with the new songs, but we always go back to the old songs. There's something about those old songs. And so, you know, we'll sing stuff like, turn your eyes upon Jesus, look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. I like this big empty room, gives me some nice reverb to sing to you all today. I'm just trying to say there's something. Your faith gets big when you go back to the basics. You know what's happened to me as a pastor? A lot of the meetings that I would normally have that centered around strategizing on how we could love people have basically, for all intents and purposes, been canceled. And now instead of having meetings where we're making plans on loving people, all that's left is loving people. And maybe some of what's gone overboard is actually helping us connect with what's basic. And I'm praying that on the other side of this storm, your marriage would look different. On the other side of this storm, your parenting would look different. On the other side of this storm, your gratefulness will have grown. There's something about getting to the other side of the storm. There's something about arriving in a place where, yeah, it's really basic, but at the same time, my faith has gotten really big. I know that your kids are probably driving you as crazy as mine are, but there's something about having them home. That there's something about not running here and going to this lesson and that practice. And I know we'll pick a lot of that up back again, but I'm just saying that maybe in this moment, what initially feels like an obstacle is actually an opportunity. So I'm praying on the other side of this, we remember our source and our steady rock and our firm foundation. There was something about all the stuff that got thrown overboard. It turned out it was just extra, and I still have what's essential. I'm telling you that if you needed it, you'd still have it. And I want to put a new declaration in your heart today. I think they might have said something like this. You know what? The boat was nice, but we don't need it. Come on. The job is nice, but at the end of the day, I don't need it. That circumstance, that part of my life that maybe brought me some comfort or some peace, you know what? It's nice, but at the end of the day, I don't need it. As long as I've got Jesus, the one that will never leave me nor forsake me, I'm going to make it through this moment. Come on, somebody, and say amen. And then what God showed me in the text is that in the storm, you remember, and here's my next point, you remember who's beside you. You remember who's beside you. Paul said, don't worry. Last night, an angel of the God whom I serve showed up and stood beside me and told me, don't be afraid. Come on, that's for somebody today. Don't be afraid. He said, you've got to stand trial, which is to say what? You can't die in this problem because you've still got a purpose. Hey, if you want to know if you've still got a purpose today, here's all you got to do. Just go like this and check your pulse. I'm telling you, if you've got a pulse, that is a sure indication that you've still got a purpose. What's so crazy, though, is that in this reassurance that Paul gives to all the other people on board, is that Paul says, hey, don't worry, you're with me, I've got a purpose, we're gonna make it through this problem, don't worry about any of that. And by the way, there are some people in your life, they're gonna get blessed just because they're on your boat. So Paul says, don't worry about any of that. But what's crazy, though, is Paul gets done saying, hey, we're gonna make it. But then there's a really big but. I mean, there is a huge but. Paul says, hey, we're gonna get there, but the ship is gonna run aground somewhere and we're gonna end up on an island somewhere. And if I'm in the boat and I'm getting that type of encouragement, I'm saying to myself, say that last part just like one more time again, because I might not have heard you right, but I thought you said something about the boat was gonna run aground and break apart. We're gonna end up on an island somewhere. Please hear me now, Cause Church. I would have preached the whole message just because God gave me this so strong in my spirit for somebody today. Just because the ship breaks apart doesn't mean your faith has to. Even while the ship falls apart, your faith can stay intact. Paul said the ship is going down, but keep your courage up, which means what? The ship is gonna sink, but that's all right, because my faith is not in a ship. My faith is in the Savior. Oh, we're gonna get there, but we might not make it here in this boat, but we're gonna make it there on something else. We don't need a boat. We're gonna make it there on this belief. I've got a bold belief that God is who he said he is, and he's gonna do what he said he's gonna do, and I can't die in this problem because I've still got a purpose. Come on, if you believe it, shout amen in the comments. My hope is not in the fact that the boat will never break. My hope is in the one whose promises never break. Sometimes the boat breaks. Sometimes something in your life that provided a level of security breaks apart. Sometimes the way you were picturing your year going, come on somebody, it breaks apart. But just because the boat breaks doesn't mean your faith has to. It might break apart, but your faith can stay intact. I'm going to make it. You're going to make it. You've got purpose on the other side of this problem. So let the ship break apart. My hope is still intact. My confidence is still intact. Come on. My faith is still intact. My trust isn't in how I'm going to get there. My trust is in the one who is taking me there. My confidence isn't in the boat. My God didn't just build the boat, but built what built the boat. My God made the trees that made the boat. Come on, somebody. We'll make it. But the ship is going to crash into an island somewhere. So it was really kind of like a good news, bad news situation, which is to say what? It's so easy in moments such as the moments that many of us are passing through, kind of like they were going through, where it was a good news, bad news. You're going to make it, but the ship is going to break. It's so easy to sort of throw up our hands and say, God, I thought you promised. And God promised, but the promise doesn't prevent the problems. Please hear me. I want this to strengthen you on the other side of that screen today. There was a promise, but it didn't prevent the problems. The promise doesn't keep you from the storm. Watch me, Cause Church. The promise keeps you in the storm. The Bible describes how they made it to the island on pieces, broken pieces of the ship. But really, they didn't make it to the island on pieces. They made it there on a promise. So no matter how you end up getting through, you keep your eyes on the one who is getting you through. And here's what hit me about this passage. It's so relevant for what we're going through as a collective people and really as a world right now, is that everybody in this passage and you and me and so many people around us, they were all, here's my next point, in the same boat. They were all in the same boat. But at the same time, while they were all in the same boat, while everybody else was panicked, only Paul was walking in peace. The difference maker in Paul's circumstance, in Paul's life, and the difference maker in your life, and the difference maker in my life will never be that we don't have problems. But what sets us apart, watch me, is our perception of those problems. It'll never be your lack of problems that makes you stand out as a believer, as a faith person, as somebody that has a confidence in Christ. It will never be a lack of problems. Nobody's ever going to come up and say, hey, you know, I've noticed that you have no problems in your life. Would you please show me to Jesus? That's not how this is going to go down. It's not your lack of problems. It's the presence of a different kind of perspective. And maybe there's never been another time when more people all felt like they were in the same boat. We're all stuck in our houses. We're all reading so many of the same headlines. We're all feeling the effects, maybe in some different ways, of this virus that's been spreading around the world. We're all wondering what it might mean for our tomorrow. We're all in the same boat. We might all be in similar problems, but we might have a very different perspective. And a little further down, verse 33, Paul calls everybody together and it says, urges them to eat something. It says, you've been in constant suspense and you've gone without food. And I couldn't help but think about the fact that so many of us, as we open our news app once again, we've been living in constant suspense. If you're anything like me, though, being quarantined and being at home, come on, you ain't going without food. Talk to me, somebody. Working from home means I've been eating way too much all day long. I'm looking around like, hey, where'd that bag of nacho cheese Doritos go? It's like, oh yeah, I ate it. And now I'm getting nacho cheese Dorito dust all over my keyboard, trying to work from my laptop. Come on, don't leave me alone. Give me your favorite food emoji in the comments there. Paul says, hey, look, you've been strung out and stressed out. You got to eat something because you've been in suspense and it's like you're starving. And I think for many of us, our issue isn't that we aren't eating. It's that we are eating. And what we are eating is leaving us in a panic, in a worry, or in fear. So here's a question today. What are you feeding on? Because you've got your Facebook feed. You've got your Twitter feed. You've got your Instagram feed. And perhaps, worst of all, you've got your news feed. And we can't feed on fear and then turn around and ask God for greater faith. At some point, We've got to stop reading news article after news article and getting ourselves worked up into a panic and then running to God crying and then labeling that prayer. And I'm not saying today that there's nothing wrong with processing in God's presence, but at some point, you got to feed yourself on something that's going to help your faith. Feed yourself on something that's going to build up your spirit. Come on, it's time to close your news app and open up your good news app. Mine's called the YouVersion. It's time to get into the promises of God. Once again, it's time to feed your faith. At some point, we got to feed our faith. So the ship breaks apart, but they make it to the island. They're saved, and they end up on this island somewhere. And I don't have time to read it all today, but they meet some of the people that live there on the island. They decide to make a fire. So Paul has already been through this crazy ordeal and is probably just wet and tired and cold, but Paul's just trying to be helpful. And so as they're building the fire, gathers some twigs, you know, some firewood, some kindling and all that, and throws it on the fire. And then out of the fire comes this viper, and Paul gets bit. And they're all like, oh, you escaped the sea, but obviously God is judging you now. You must be a murderer. You escaped the sea. Now you're going to die by this snake. But watch this. Paul shakes off the snake and stands there, and there's no ill effects from this bite. And then in the very next moment, while they were saying, hey, you're getting judged by God, now they're saying, you are a God. Which, by the way, is just a reminder. You can't allow the fickle opinions of people to affect your sense of purpose, because it changes real quick. But here's my next point. We're going to shut this down quick, but we got to talk about the bite. We got to talk about the bite. Now watch this. It never says that the bite didn't sting. See, you might still feel the sting of the bite. You might still have to deal with the viper, but you've got an immunity to the venom. Oh, I've been so excited to preach this to you. You might still have to deal with the bite of this virus. Your income in this moment might be on shaky ground. You might have to make some tough decisions concerning your family. You might still have to deal with the bite, but here's what God told me to tell you. It's not gonna get in your blood. Come on, believer, it's time to shake it off, and you're still gonna be standing. There might be a viper, but you won't be affected by the venom, and no weapon formed against me will prosper. That's what the Bible says. It never says that the weapon won't be formed, but when the weapon is formed, it will fail. And watch this. What the enemy sent to be poison, God is going to use according to your purpose. God worked it according to purpose. Not only did Paul not drop dead from the effects of the poison, but now all of a sudden Paul got noticed, watch me, by a whole lot of people. Specifically by one person named Publius. And here's my last point. We got to talk about what happened on the beach. The beach. The people on the beach. The beach where they were never supposed to end up being on. They all took notice, especially this one person who had a sick parent who was actually suffering with a fever. Sounds pretty familiar. Watch this in Acts 28, verses 7 through 9. There was an estate nearby that belonged to Publius, the chief official on the island. Welcomed us into his home, showed us generous hospitality for 3 days. His father was sick in bed, suffering from fever and dysentery. Paul went in to see him, and after prayer, placed his hands on him and healed him. Then watch this. When this had happened, the rest of the sick on the island came and were cured. Not just the one, but everyone on the island was cured. So what on the one side felt like a crisis, now on the other side was many people being cured. What on the one side felt like a hardship, on the other side was many people being healed. And they were never supposed to be there. They weren't supposed to shipwreck. Nobody plans on having these kinds of problems. They were planning on being in Rome by now. They were supposed to be somewhere else. And maybe right now you're sitting in a place that wasn't part of the plan. You weren't planning on having to deal with these kinds of problems. You weren't planning on being stuck at home. You weren't planning on having to make it through this kind of mess. But sometimes you can't decide where you are, but you can decide who you are. And you know what I think Paul said at some point, washed up on this island on broken pieces? I think Paul must have said something like this: well, I wasn't planning on being here, but since I'm here, since I'm here, I'm going to pray and heal the sick. Since I'm here, I'm going to point to Jesus. Since I'm here, I'm going to lead some islanders to the Lord. Since I'm here, I didn't plan on it, but since I'm here at home, I'm going to build up my kids like I never have before. Since I'm here in this place where I'm stuck online, I'm going to share so much faith that I'm going to eradicate fear. Come on, put that declaration in your spirit. Somebody say it in the comments. Since I'm here, it wasn't part of the plan, but since I'm here, I'm going to point to Jesus. Since I'm here, I'm going to build my marriage. Since I'm here, come on, I'm going to grow closer to God than I ever have been before. Since I'm here. And watch this. Just because it wasn't part of the plan doesn't mean that it wasn't part of God's purpose. Come on, just because it wasn't in your plans doesn't mean that it's not God's purpose. And what might have appeared initially to look like an obstacle, it turns out, is an opportunity. And watch me, this healing on this island, it went viral. I'm praying God gives you a hope that goes viral in your family. I'm praying God gives you a faith that goes viral with your coworkers. I'm praying God gives you a confidence that goes viral with people around you that are facing crisis. Come on, put that declaration in your spirit and in your mouth today. I wasn't planning on being here, but since I'm here, I'm going to point to the Savior. Hey, if you're watching this worship experience online today and maybe you feel as though you're far from God, I want to encourage you to know that you're actually not as far as it might feel. You're actually just one step away. We have a God that loves us so much and loves you specifically so much that all of heaven was bankrupt and Jesus showed up on this planet, died a criminal's death on a cross, only to get up on the third day that you might be saved. I believe that Jesus is calling you by your name. I might not know your name on the other side of the screen, but there is a God in heaven that does. And you're only one step away, and that's calling on the name of Jesus today. What I'm trying to say is that if you want to be saved, if you want to come back to Jesus today, maybe life happened, maybe circumstances arose and something kind of eroded your relationship with God. God's waiting with open arms today. I want to invite you into the opportunity to give your life to Jesus. I'm going to ask that in just a moment you pray with me in your heart. And there's also a place on our website, thecausecda.com, where you can click a button. We want to help you take several next steps. And you have to serve Jesus by yourself, but you don't have to do it on your own. You're surrounded by people, and we want to be with you, and we want to help you take those steps. And so go to the website, click that button. But hey, if you're giving your life to Jesus or back to Jesus today, pray with me now. Jesus, I come to you and I put my faith and my trust and my hope and my confidence in you. I pray now and I ask Jesus that you would wash me in the cleansing power of your blood, that I might be made new and I might be transformed. Would you fill me with your Holy Spirit, that I might get up out of spiritual death and take a step into spiritual life. Jesus, thank you for knowing my name. Now I call in your name, the name of Jesus. You are the way, the truth, and the life. Thank you for saving me and making me yours and making me a Christian today. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen and amen. Cause Church, we love you. I'm praying that you continue to experience the presence of God throughout your week. Stay connected with us on social media. I can't wait to see you soon.
Hey guys, that was such an amazing message from Pastor Aaron. We are so thankful for him. And I just want to encourage anybody that gave your life to Jesus today. We want to connect with you. We really believe that you have to make the decision to serve Jesus for yourself, but you don't have to do it by yourself. And so we actually have right on our front page of our website, there is a button that says, I'm a new believer. You can click that button and we want to connect with you. Fill out the form and we want to get a hold of you and really explain to you what your next steps might be. And another fun thing that we have today is we would love to be meeting with you in the lobby of our church, but obviously we can't do that. So we have set up a virtual lobby on Facebook Live right now. So as soon as you guys get done with this, you can go over to Facebook Live. Pastor Aaron and Pastor Rochelle will be on there. And we are gonna have a virtual lobby where you can connect with them. You can talk back and forth with them. So jump over onto that right now. But we love you guys. Thank you so much. And we'll see you next week.